Together, humbly I adore thee, hidden Godhead, veiled truly under these figures. All of my heart I give to thee, for it all fails contemplating thee. Sight, touch, and taste tell me nothing of thy presence. Yet safely I trust what I hear. I believe whatever Son God has said. Nothing can be more true than the word of truth itself. On the cross, thy Godhead was hidden. Here is hidden the manhood too. Yet I believe, confess both, praying as I pray the good word. I do not see thy wounds like Thomas, yet I confess thee, my God. Grant that I may evermore more believe in thee, hope in thee, love thee, O memory of the ineffable Lord, living bread, bring life to man. Let me ever live for thee, ever sweetly taste thee, pelican of mercy, Jesus Lord, cleanse me, unclean by thy blood, of which one drop is enough to wash the world of all sin. Jesus, whom I see veiled, I pray that this may come for which I long so much, the blessed seeing thee face to face, may bless by the sight of thy glory.
Listen now to a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, "I thirst." A bowl of vinegar stood there, so they put a sponge full of the vinegar on hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Please be seated. We cannot speak of the Christian life unless we speak of the Sabbath, the every first day of the week. It's a point of arrival from the last week. It's also a point of departure, getting launched into the next week. And the thing I love about John's gospel is that he takes a lot of elements we find in the book of Genesis, and he incorporates them in his gospel. So when our Lord was on the cross, when we look at how John puts this in John chapter 19, we have a replay going on what happened in Genesis chapter 1, the Spirit hovering over the waters of the face of the earth, bringing beauty and order out of chaos and nothingness. So when our Lord died on the cross, he breathes the Spirit. That gesture, that imagery is exactly the same what we see in Genesis chapter 1. And then when our Lord dies, nothing is supposed to happen. Our Lord surrendered his life to the embrace of our Heavenly Father. And when the soldiers come and pierce the Lord in his side, out come streams of blood and water. So we've got all three things. We've got the Spirit being breathed, we've got the blood, and we've got the water. So the Lord is making a new creation. He's creating his spouse, the church. Just as we were born, just as Eve was made from the side of Adam, so we too are born from the side of Christ himself. Now, it's very interesting because in 6 days, God created the entire earth, and he commanded us to rest on the Sabbath. Another way to put that is we need to be recreated, right? And we're living at a time where people think that if they rest, that means they're being a bunch of lazy bums, or they're doing nothing, they're not being productive. Ours is a neurotic world. Now, in the book of Revelation, the demonic number that St. John tells us about is a mockery of those 6 days. It's a rejection of Sabbath rest. So when we refuse to be recreated, when we refuse to be redeemed by the blood and water which flow from our Lord, we're really missing out on so much. We're refusing to live as God's beloved children. So when we are not aware of the Sabbath, when we're not practicing that Sabbath rest, what we're really doing is we're saying, "I need to redeem the world, I need to save the world, or I need to save me." But we all try to do that apart from Christ. So we need rest, we need that recreation. Now, when we continue in John's gospel here, and the Lord pulls a breaking and entering with the apostles, they're all hanging out in the upper room. John tells us the first day of the week, the doors being shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came in, he stands among them and says to them, "Peace be with you." This is a very strange thing that Jesus does. He knows that the apostles, they beat feet, okay? They ran away, but they know that he was crucified. He goes in, and rather than saying, "Here I am," he goes up to them. He says, "Peace be with you." He shows them his hands in his side, and then he breathes on them. That's creepy. That's really nuts. But it's an exact replay of what happens on the cross, okay? When the Lord breathes that spirit. That's why he's breathing on them. So the Lord is taking the fruits of the cross. He's taking the sacrifice of the cross, and he is turning that and transforming that into a sacrament, okay? So I have a little pop quiz for you. Does the Mass exist in order to give us Holy Communion? Yes or no? Does the Mass exist so that we can have Holy Communion? Wow, it's a quiet crowd. A lot of people think because we're living in a very consumeristic world, one of the things that's absolutely killing our church right now is consumerism. Every Ash Wednesday, I feel bad for every church secretary throughout the world because the phone's ringing off the hook, and my secretary at Good Shepherd was yelled at last year because we had the audacity to not offer drive-through ashes. And it's very easy when we come into church and when we pray, okay, well, I'm supposed to get something. I kind of go through the motions. And the Eucharist is not a product. The Eucharist is not a thing. The Eucharist is a person. And when I receive the Eucharist, and the Lord wants us to receive him, he's yearning for our faith, what I'm saying to God, what I'm saying in a very public way is I'm not only believing in my Catholic faith, I'm also professing to live that Catholic faith. So the mystery of the Eucharist, the mystery of Holy Communion is really given to us so that we can immerse ourselves in what the Mass is, the prayer of Jesus Christ on his cross. The only difference between what happened on the cross and what happens on this altar is the manner. A lot of people get caught up in what a sacrament or a sacramental is. So I want you to think about that. When you say amen, when the priest or the deacon says the body of Christ, you are giving the Lord permission to embrace you with his cross, which leads to the resurrection. Okay. We need to allow ourselves to be embraced by the cross because that is how we receive rest, that is how we are recreated, and that is how we are redeemed.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord. Affection at every moment in all the tabernacles of